So, good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone, and welcome to this technical briefing today, Advances in Code Summarization. My name is Xavier Franc from the Technical University of Catalunya in Barcelona, and I will be moderating the session. This technical briefing is presented, or is offered by three researchers from IBM Research, Utkarsh Desai, Giri Prasad Sitara, and Srikanth Tamilselvan. And Utkarsh and Srikanth are present here and will be the ones that will conduct the presentation. So at this moment, I give them the floor and they will manage completely the technical briefing. So everything up to you. Welcome everyone and let's enjoy the session.
Thanks Xavier, for the kind introduction. Okay. So just to introduce myself, so I am Srikanth Tamilselvan. I am a senior software engineer and manager at IBM Research Labs, Bangalore, India. And with me here in this presentation is Utkarsh Desai. And together we work on problems at the intersection of both AI and software engineering. And this topic is very dear to us. So our everyday challenges are around how to apply AI on traditional software engineering problems like code clustering, code translation, and even code summarization. So we thought like we'll give a brief presentation on some of the recent works that have tried to push this boundary of research in a big way. So that will be the major focus of this talk. The agenda for the talk is the following. First, I'll formally introduce the code summarization task. We'll also give a quick overview of characteristics of what makes a summary good. Then we will look into why it is needed and what do people do when there's a lack of comments. And then we will introduce some of the key concepts that are there to understand some of the advanced works or the recently published works. And along the way, I'll also briefly present some of the early works, so which can still be inspiring. And in many practical scenarios, those works are still applicable. We will also discuss some of the data sets that were generated over the course of time, which helped to push this area of research strongly, and some of the evaluation strategies that were also put in place. So we'll go into the details with respect to each work that are prominent. And Utkarsh will present in detail some of the very recent works. It will mostly involve works based on neural networks. And finally, we want to conclude our presentation with key takeaways and the future direction for this area of research. So these are the things we want to cover in the briefing. So formally, if I have to introduce the task of code summarization, it is nothing but a high-level description about the function, okay? So it tries to understand the intent of the code and aims to generate a good description about what it does. And we feel a summary should have the following characteristics. First of all, it should not be misleading. It should be very accurate to the functionality of the code. It can be a statement, it can be a small code block, or it can be a function or a class, but it should be accurate and not misleading. Secondly, it should try to cover the core aspects of the code. It is very difficult to capture all of them. Sometimes if you try to go into the details of how it goes and everything, it can get very verbose. So it should maintain a fine balance, but definitely it should cover key aspects of the code, which will help the developer in the future. Okay. Finally, there are a couple of more points. So it should also be consistent. This is something, we don't give much attention, but practically it matters a lot. So when you maintain a large project and you have so much of code everywhere, you want to have certain kind of standardization in the format. So that will help. And finally, the generation or the comments that are entered manually should be fluent or it should be easily understandable. What we practically see is a lot of times the code blocks are as such, right, kept in the comment section itself. So that should be avoided. It should be understandable for for any native person to start working on the tool. So we discussed about code summarization, but what are code comments and why are they needed? Comments, like I said, right, it's about a description of the code, but why are they needed? I think it is straightforward, right? So if you want to maintain large software, you will see people going in and going out of the project. So you want something to be always there to refer for the future. And practically what happens is in an industrial setting, when you work on a product, their lifespan will cross multiple years. And then you will see people with different background coming and joining, contributing to different modules and leaving. Over time, right, the original developers who worked on the product or that particular code will not be available. So at those times, if there is some change to be done, then people rely a lot on comments. And there was a study that said like roughly 59% of the time in the code maintenance is a lot spent on actually code comprehension, basically understand the code, rather than working on the key maintenance tasks like code fixing or right, small improvements like that. So that's a core motivation from the industry point of view, and it's a very practical challenge. So the motivation has always been there, the problem has always been there, but somehow it continues to still persist. And like I said, most of the times you will see developers working on somebody else's code. So that's another key reason why people should pay much attention to having good comments. And the third one is actually what happens a lot. So you have your first version of code. So maybe the person might have due diligently tried to write the comments. But when they make the change, they sometimes don't try to adjust the comments or update the comments accordingly. So in Eclipse, you have functions like capabilities, like you need add a new, let's say you inserted a throws exception new, it has capability to add that in the declaration at the top. But the functionality, right, many of the IDEs currently don't support. So that's another reason why the developers have to be conscious and make sure their recent changes are updated accordingly in the comments also. But nevertheless, these things, right, never happens, or at least not happens consistently. So that's why there's a need for automatic way to generate code summaries. This will help a lot, right, for the developers. So not only for maintaining the code, but also to in other tasks, right, especially code search tasks. So if you want to quickly understand, borrow some modules, it's easier to search by the comments. So it helps a lot in the code search task too. There's no substitute for having comments, but let's see what people do when there are no comments. So they try to look into some of the identify names to understand the functionality. So people stress a lot, irrespective of whether you actually write the comments. The identifiers also should be more business function oriented, basically function oriented. People try to automate such a way that when you write your code, if there are no comments added, there can be prompts. So that's an industrial practice that is happening. But more importantly, I think people try to rely on generating comments automatically. Identify the core statements and try to come up with the phrases or a long summary. So this is how people practically deal with lack of code comments. Coming to the different automated code summarization approaches, right? From a different lens, you can view it in different ways. So I can see this from the point of view of what all features were used to summarize the code, whether you treated code as just code or code as text, how heavily used AST, or whether you worked only on the code tokens, or did you look only into the functions, etc. There are multiple.
It seems we lost for a second, Skirant.
Yeah, let me check with Srikanth.
Okay.
Yeah, of course.
Yes, we lost you for a second, Skirant.
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yes, now it's okay.
Okay. So I was just saying, like, different people might have different perspective on how to look into the different approaches, the different bodies of work in this code summarization task. So this is just our point of view. We relied mostly on the techniques used. So at the very beginning, it was right more of term-based summarization that was popular. So basically, you try to extract key phrases out of those functional blocks that can best represent that module. Okay, and primarily information retrieval techniques were used for this body of work. But there are also other works that use templates. And this is something that even today in our project, we practically use. I'll go into the use case when I go into this particular approach in detail. But I feel that this is a practical approach. Because based on your target audience, you might want to generate a particular summary so that it is most beneficial for them. Then there was also a body of work which relied on external resources for summarizing your code. Okay. And then there's this heavy body of work that are based on machine learning techniques. And this will be a key focus of our tutorial today. But before we go there, let me introduce briefly about some key works in the first three approaches. And we were inspired about viewing this body of work through the work done by Yuzheng Zhu, which is referred, we have cited them here. So we found their survey very useful for looking into this area of work. Okay, on the term-based summarization techniques, so we see there are a lot of body of work that looked either into the retrieval techniques or were focusing on the position of the text. Position of text might sound very strange now, but it is a popular concept even in the general text summarization techniques. So even when people had to summarize a general document, right, a paragraph, you would find that invariantly the first sentence was always retained. So, and it was even proved with human study that there's a lot of attention goes into the first sentence. So the position matters a lot. And this was also leveraged in the code summarization task. So there were like key position that were always retained to describe about the function block. And then there were a lot of work which used IR techniques. And any of this work, the first step is almost the same. So you try to take the source code, you try to extract token through some delimiters, and then you either decide to split or retain. So different works try to split even the token. Sometimes they kept it as such, whatever they say in the actual code block. And then they try to use different weighing schemes to see the importance of that word with respect to the code file they belong to. So one such is represented here in this table here. So you can consider these as some tokens that you see in your code file across different code files. And then these are the different code files that you consider here. So class A is an individual code file, class B is an individual code file. I'm just calling it in a very abstract form. Based on the language, you might call it differently. In Java, it can be class, in Angular, it can be just programs, etc. Okay. Then you can, people use predominantly vector space model and LSI model to weigh the tokens here, and then the top ones were selected as the candidates to represent that code block. Okay. But one key drawback here is that just tags alone might not be helpful. Okay, so it can give an indication of what it means. And we also use tags in general to quickly understand about the topic, but they might not be helpful if you want to go deep. If you want to truly understand and maintain them, tags are not enough. So that was a drawback, but nevertheless, it is a quick work, and it helps to quickly get an understanding of what that function ideally does. And we just wanted to credit some of the prominent work, so that's listed down. Next, I'll go into this template-based summarization techniques. I'm just calling this as a very practical approach because this is something that I feel is something that is done even today. So even in my project. So let me give that example. So we work on a project where we try to cluster code files. So basically we work on this software decomposition task. And at a high level, we call this as a monolith to microservices task. So we try to group a few set of programs and say like, hey, this set of programs, they are functionally coherent, and then they are a candidate microservice. But this information and the reason for why we group needs to be informed to the SMEs, okay? So here the persona is not just a developer, but a business SME who tries to work with the business people and the individual developers. The best way we felt was to come up with templates that will capture the key information. In our case, we try to identify few information like what are all the data objects, how many classes it contained, what is the kind of dependency with the other clusters, what are the different tables that are present in that cluster, etc. So this was very specific to code clustering, but we saw earlier in other works. Just to understand a functional block itself, there were templates introduced. So given a software, they try to identify the number of interfaces in a particular package. Given a method, they try to identify what is the parameter and data type, etc. Based on the context, it depends. But people introduce this concept of templates where there are some fields that are left and that are filled when you work on a particular code fragment. So this is one particular example, okay? And the templates also, right? This body of work also dependent or relied a lot on this software word usage model, okay? So what it does is, it given a particular code statement or a program statement, it tries to output these three parts. One is the noun, verb, and optionally secondary argument. And people try to associate verbs a lot with actions and nouns as an item that performs that action, etc. There are a lot of different works that try to interpret the output of this model and fill the templates. So a lot of works came out of this approach, and many of them made sense. But the key drawback is there is a lot of effort that goes into template generation. So you will have to work a lot with, and for different persona, this can change. And even when you have all the templates, what you fill still comes from the code block, and you're still extracting them. If that quality is bad, right, then you're not going to gain much with this approach too. For example, if I'm going to replace remove with RV, right? And even if I have a good template that can explain the context, but without a good identify name, it's going to be still difficult. So I feel that that's a drawback, but nevertheless, this approach is still applicable in today's time too. Next, there was a good amount of work, and there are still a lot of work that works on summarizing based on external sources. You guys might have heard about the announcement from Microsoft and OpenAI just 2 days ago. So they are collaborating to apply GPT-3 model to generate programs based on the learning from GitHub. So these approaches are inspired from the early works that that relied on Stack Overflow and general right other repositories like GitHub. So here, so what you essentially get in many of these online forums are a good program statements and then a good description. So in Stack Overflow, we all tend to go and pose some questions along with some code fragments, and then folks will try to give some solution. Maybe that might involve some description about the solution and as well as a code fragment on how, right, on the response. So these code and description mapping can be extracted and can be utilized for summarization. Similarly, you see that the there is a lot more emphasis given to proper code commenting when you contribute to open source. So again, this is a rich information that you are getting, right? A functional block along with good right code with which you can learn. So these sources gives you a good code and description mapping. And then the task typically involves, like, once you can extract all this information, given the code block that you for which you want to generate the summary, it's about, right, how do you find the best pair or the best match. Okay, so you can apply different techniques in the code clone detection body of work, and then you can rank them, or you can directly borrow that description and apply for your code block. Again, this was there were a lot of works in this area, and with the announcement like from Microsoft to OpenAI, you see that, all right, this body of work is going to only increase. So like I said, we will go into the machine learning based approaches, but before that, I feel like maybe we can just spend at a very high level some key concepts that will help us understand those area of work better. Okay, this is by no means good enough material to quickly understand all these concepts, but we just wanted to introduce them so that you can quickly relate when Utkarsh goes into the details of the advanced models. So we'll start with very few basic concepts. I added some credits, and you can refer them post the talk also to go into the details if you are interested to learn more about them. Okay. So basis of many of the recent works have been usage of RNNs and LSTMs. Okay, so we wanted to cover that first. So RNNs are a natural choice when you want to work on some sequence of data. Okay, so the traditional neural networks did not support or could not handle sequence information, and RNNs were introduced just for that purpose. As you can see here, this is how typically an RNN will be represented. It takes an input, produces an output, and there's a loop here which tells that the information flow keeps happening. And this is an unrolled version of the single RNN network here. So what you essentially see is it takes an input, it produces an output, but it also gives a signal to the next network. Okay. And you can see that it's almost identical. Each network here is identical. It performs the same action, just that the output produced is dependent on the previous network's output. So that's how the output of each network varies, but otherwise the function is same for all of them. Okay. And in the deep learning world, people refer these as internal memory or internal scripts. Okay. So you will see that we refer a lot them as hidden states. And sometimes in the literature, you see that this is considered as a temporary memory. Okay. But there were drawbacks So theoretically, RNNs were supposed to handle sequence of data. It was supposed to remember sequence it saw from the long past, but practically it did not work out that way. So that's where variations of RNNs came. So LSTMs and GRU were introduced and they were a big hit. So it works a similar way, but internally inside this network, there are like multiple gates that tells either the LSTM unit or a GR unit on what to remember and forget. And it has multiple functions, at least four functions for LSTM compared to a single TANH or ELU function and RNN. So these gates and these functions help the network to update the information as well as decide what to forget. Okay. So we felt that we saw that RNNs are good for handling sequence of data, but to solve a function end to end, this encoder and decoder architecture were quite popular. You'll see a lot of work which used encoder or decoder architecture for this code summarization task too. So basically, what encoder does is it's again a series of RNN stack. And what it does is it takes an input, encodes that information. Basically, it passes, it works at input and it passes that input to the next network here. And then it works on its input. Basically, each one can be an individual token that is passed. And then it also, since it looks into the past one, so it basically has some context of the previous input. So this particular input here, I wouldn't say input. So this network takes the current input and the hidden state of the previous input. So basically it has some information of what was the earlier token, and that is given to the next network. So this way, the information about the sequence of token passed is captured. And then finally, the last network in the encoder captures the context information of the whole input. Okay, so typically folks refer this as a context vector. So this context vector is supposed to capture the sequential information of the whole set of tokens that were passed. And once this context vector is available, then it is passed to the decoder. Okay. So again, these are again could be RNNs or it could be any other network. Okay, you can replace LSTM here, or you can use something else. And you can see here the size need not be the same. Okay. So you need not have the same number of steps that you use to encode an information to decode that same information. Okay, so that's one thing we wanted to highlight. And the decoder works a similar way. It takes a context vector. Each network takes that input, produces an output, and that output is passed to the next network. And then it then does the same step again and again. Finally, when you try to generate the last token to complete your output. Okay. So this architecture is what you'll predominantly see in a lot of the works that happened in like 2-3 years before. Moving on. So there are a couple of drawbacks or limitations in this architecture. So one of them is this architecture doesn't help you with help you with giving differential importance to different tokens. Okay. So at the decoder side, what you have is the input of the complete encoded information. It doesn't tell you like how important a particular token is for a particular output. Okay. So that's where attention comes. So when I say I ordered hot coffee, okay, so the coffee, the reason why it is there, it can be best explained by this particular token order more than, right, I or hot. Definitely hot and coffee, definitely it is important. But comparatively for this token, in this particular context, ordered is more important and it should have it should pay more attention. Okay. So similarly, between these, you can say like this need not be, right? This need not have so much attention. So basically the point is not every token in a input is equally important. So you need to capture relative importance of the tokens within an input itself. Okay. So that was one. The second drawback is like it is highlighted here. So in the earlier one, you saw that there was one hidden state for the whole, right, for the whole encoder step. But here we pass the entire hidden state, right, for each time step. So you try to give the entire context, not just expect the last encoder step to capture the whole context, but pass the entire encoding step context for the decoder so that it can decide by attending each of the encoder step, like what is more important for it to come up with the output. So it typically has three steps. Okay, so the encoding remains the same, like the original sequence to sequence model. Just the output here is not just one hidden vector, but a hidden vector of all the encoding states. Then the decoder, what it does is, it takes the initial hidden state and then the last token of the encoder, and then it processes them, right, to come up with this new hidden state vector. Okay, so it will discard the output, okay, and then it will use that hidden state vector and then attend on all the encoding hidden states. So this is where the alignment happens. Okay, so this tells for that particular step, looking into all the inputs, what is its relative importance, and then right, just to complete them, they are all concatenated so that you get the overall attention of how much this particular output depends on all the inputs that right that was given. So that the combination of these three steps tells you the importance of how much a token should give importance to the different tokens that were passed in the encoders. So this is the key difference, and this helped a lot in many of the tasks. So moving on. So in the earlier one, you saw this attention was done between these two architectures, and generally RNN were used. But then do we even need them, right? So the input embeddings, basically the input that you give itself has rich information, right? It does capture semantic information when you convert those inputs into an embedding space. So why can't we take each of them and try to compare with each other and try to find out how much this particular token is important to others, or how much other tokens are important for this particular token? So this is a basic philosophy behind the self attention. Okay, so before I go into this different matrix, right, let me tell you how it works. So given an input token and then all the tokens given a set of input tokens, if you want to find an attention for a particular token, so let's take an example. So let's say there are tokens T1, T2, T3, and then you want to find the self attention of T1. So basically how much T1 needs attention from all these different other tokens in the inputs. So what you do is you do a multiplication of this input token T1 with respect to all the other tokens. Okay, and then typically dot product is done. So this gives you a similarity of right, this token with respect to all the tokens. Obviously, when you multiply T1 and T1, its similarity score is going to be high. But then we know, right, a token can have different semantics, right? And based on the context, it might mean something. So that's why it's still important to multiply a token with its own token itself. Generally, people scale them down so that the gradients are more stable, and then they apply a softmax function on top, and then you multiply the output of this attended token with T1, T2, 3, 3 with the, again, its input, basically T1, T2, 3, 3 to get the final output. So what are this matrix here? So these are the weights that the deep learning network will try to learn when it does this processing. Okay, so a quick formulation is given here on how this can be done. So basically you try to do a softmax over the dot product of query and key terms, and then you try to scale down to the dimension of key, and then you multiply with the value, basically the value vector which you get by multiplying the input token with all the tokens in the input. Okay, so this self-attention is highly used in this famous architecture called transformers. So this is seen as a significant work, and it has influenced a wide area of topics in the general text domain. And you can see that it's increasingly being used in the code summarization task too. So again, it works on few basic principles. It definitely works on self-attention. It tries to get away with your usual RNNs and LSTMs. And what it tries to do is, instead of leaning on one attention, it just tries to pack multiple self-attention blocks so that you get better performance and you can handle long inputs. So some of the key characteristics of the transformers are the following. First, it allows parallel processing. So as you can see, each input token works with all the other inputs, and then it maintains its life cycle. Okay, so it need not cross each other's path. So parallelization is feasible in this work. Second, like I mentioned, this transformers got rid of RNNs and LSTMs. So basically, we need some way to maintain sequence. So this is where positional encoding was introduced. Basically, you add some index along with your input embedding so that you also maintain or retain the position, okay, when you process them. Finally, the residual concept was brought in here. So this was very famous in the vision work, and this was brought in here so that the gradients can naturally flow in the network. And another key characteristic is this mass multi-head attention that we see. Okay, so when you work on the input, you want to look into the complete input sequence. But when you are working on the output, you don't want to get influenced, or you don't want to know the future. You only want to take the next decision based on the currently generated output. So that's why masking is applied in the decoder side, but not in the encoder side. Again, the reason why we want to introduce these concepts are, you will see that many of the recent works leverage these frameworks, just that they adapted the input in the context that these transformers can work well. Okay. So there's also a good body of work on using reinforcement learning for code summarization tasks. And there are multiple ways in which a reinforcement learning problem can be solved. One very popular way is this, this actor-critic approach. So basically, before I go into the actor-critic approach, let me introduce some of the other key concepts that are generally applicable in reinforcement learning. So there is this concept of environment where an agent, in this case, in actor-critic model, can be an actor or a critic who will operate or who will work on this environment, and then they take some action, okay, and then based on the action, they tend to get some feedback, okay. So that is commonly referred as reward in RL, and when you take some action, you also tend to move from one state to the other. Okay, so this is concept of state also. And then you will commonly come across these two concepts called as policy and value. So policy is nothing but a mapping of a particular agent's state to an action. So it's a state to action space. It tells you what actions can be performed when you are in a particular state. So if you take a chess like a game, when you go to a particular position, you know, like from here, what are all the possible options based on what kind of player you are. And then there's also the concept of value, which is also critical, and people try to optimize, right, the value function. Basically, it tries to tell you or estimate what will be the reward by being in the particular state or, right, by taking a particular action. Okay. So coming to this this autocratic model, which is one of a popular reinforcement learning approach. So they try to optimize these two, or they try to learn these two functions. One is the policy function, which tells you what is the best action that you can take from a particular state. So like with this guideline, right? And this is heavily influenced by the critic, who tells you or who will estimate what is the reward you can take by going to a particular state or by taking a particular action in a state. Okay. So the critic will estimate the reward and then guide the actor on how to best learn the right, this policy, basically what the optimal action you should take to in a particular state. So again, we just wanted to give you a quick introduction of some of the key concepts here and key models. If you want to learn more, I think there are enough materials available, and many of the recent works leverage some of these concepts in different ways to achieve best accuracy in software, in code summarization tasks. Okay, so maybe now I'll hand it over to Utkarsh.
Yeah, thank you, Shigan. Yeah, so let me start. So continuing with our agenda, right? So what we want to do is we want to look at what has been happening very recently in the space of code summarization. And quite clearly, there is literally a lot of attention given to this particular area. We see more and more labs and more teams starting to pay attention to kind of all the different code related tasks. And I mean it quite literally, as we will see the amount of attention that is present in all this work, right? But the major issue is that like there are so many papers and so many works that have been coming out specifically in the past 4 or 5 years. And like, clearly, if you look for works that have been focusing on just in the domain of code, applying machine learning or deep learning on code, they'll easily find 100 plus papers that do that, right? So there's clearly a lot of work going on here. So there are two things that we could do, right? We could have cherry picked certain interesting works, and we could have spent more time on it. But we felt that would not do justice to all the amazing work that people have been doing, the different teams have been doing. So instead, what we are planning to do now is we are going to focus more on the coverage, and we'll try to shed light on the different ways in which people apply all the different deep learning methods in the problem of code summarization. We'll try to focus on covering more papers and more of these works rather than going into any specific set of works in too much detail. So our emphasis is going to be more on identifying novel approaches or formulations of this problem, but like not necessarily look at the state of the art results or the best results among these works. So what we want to focus on in this talk is on the approach that the different teams take, how they take the input, how they process it, and why we feel that their explanation or their justifications make sense, right? So we'll try to go into their motivations behind taking inputs and selecting certain models and so on. And we will briefly mention results, but we'll not spend too much time on analyzing them in detail. Again, like because we're trying to bring in like a lot of different works, probably we won't have a lot of time to spend on all the results in too much detail. One thing that is going to help, given the background that Shrikant just gave us, is to think in terms of abstraction. What I mean is, think of all the machine learning components or architectures as some kind of a black box to understand what they essentially do. For example, if you're talking of an encoder-decoder approach, right, it helps to think of an encoder as something that takes an input and produces a fixed length output for that input, right? And which is then passed on to the decoder, right? So without going into too much detail of how the encoder works and like how the decoder works and how they pass information, if you think in terms of an abstract entity, I think that will help us better in understanding of all these works that we're going to talk about. And finally, what we want to kind of emphasize and hope that you guys take home with you is how people have been using all these existing techniques in very novel ways and applying all sorts of tricks to, you know, to adapt to specifically the code related problems that we'll face, and how we have a huge diversity in data sets and data representations, and like, you know, how people have been, you know, constantly trying to adapt the data as well as the models for this particular domain. And we'll at the end, we'll look at some of the open questions, and there will be like a good food for thought if some of you are interested, you know, in research in this particular area, right? So the way we're going to divide the following part of the session is that we'll first focus on some initial primary approaches. What I mean is these are relatively simpler approaches which have been explored initially, and yet they use some kind of a simpler model architectures comparatively to what we've been seeing very recently, but they still achieve somewhat impressive results, especially given the time when these methods came out, right? And later on towards the end, we will look some of the more complex and more composite approaches which involve either multiple formulations or multiple related tasks. They also combine multiple architectures or deep learning paradigms. And obviously, because of this added complexity, most of the time they do outperform the primary approaches that we talked about earlier. But still, like, you know, they still have some shortcomings and some areas of improvement that we'll also address. So to introduce the whole thing formally, right? We are looking at code summarization, but typically code summarization exists in two flavors, and most of the works and most of the papers can handle either or both of these formulations. The first is to predict a method's name. So given a code snippet, which is typically just a function or a method, we want to, like, the task is like, you know, if you're going to mask the method name, we want to give the rest of the code to a deep learning model and have it predict the method name. And because we already have the method name, you can directly check if the deep learning model did a good job of predicting the method name. So that is the task for method name prediction, which again counts as code summarization because you're still summarizing it to some extent, like what the method does. And the other task is actually generating the documentation string, the doc string, right? Which is slightly harder, but it is more common to, you know, like refer to, like, you know, when people talk about code summarization, it typically mean documentation generation, because that's what the actual summary is supposed to tell you, right? What the method is doing in a free form textual description. And this is sometimes also referred to as code captioning, because you can think of it as a caption to the code that you provide as input. And again, in this particular case as well, the code is still most of the time a function or a method in a particular language, and we want to generate the documentation string for that particular function, which is given as an input. So here you can see some examples, right? Like over here, the ideal method name here is supposed to be contained signature case. And similarly, you can see the actual, if someone were to write the documentation for this particular method, it would most likely be something along the lines of, you know, replacing a string from a text file. So this is what we expect the model or the network to generate. And we will see how different approaches try to handle this particular task. So even though this is our main task, a lot of the times it helps to consider information from other tasks, because they're all related to code in general. So a lot of the times you will see works that kind of, you know, marry code summarization with code search or code generation, because they're all kind of related to understanding what the particular snippet of code does or a particular language, like, you know, English language text does, right? So for example, if you're searching for code, like, you know, give me a function to replace a string from a file, right? You need to know what that means, and you also need to know what a corresponding code would look like. So all of these tasks kind of boil down to understanding the language and understanding the code, and then using that information to solve the whatever task you're kind of interested in, right? So there are related tasks. Not all of the time do people use them in their models, but they do help, as we will see in the few slides going forward. That like a lot of the times, even code summarization, not the, just the primary objective, there are some other objectives as well, which eventually do help code summarization task. And like luckily, in, over the last few years, we've seen a lot of data sets being made available publicly. So I've just listed some of them. There are still a few more data sets that are definitely not listed here. But like, as you can see, right, like we've been lucky enough in this particular field that we have data sets in different languages and of different sizes. So in that way, if someone is looking to kind of, you know, just get their hands dirty with this in this area of code summarization, I think there is a lot of ways to start. And as you see, right, like there are a lot of new data sets that are also coming up. People are generating variations of these data sets and they're crawling their own data sets. So over the next few years, I think like even more data sets with more variation and more properties would be available. And just to put it out there, right, like typically you measure, okay, so our objective is to measure how good of a documentation was generated by a model, right? We're looking for a summarization task. So I want to measure if a model generates a summary, how good that summary is. Now, this is very, again, like most of the time, the summary is going to be in pure English language. So most the a lot of the metrics that are commonly used to measure the quality of the generated code summary are the same as the metrics that are commonly used to generate the quality of translation text or text generation model, right, in your natural language processing field. So all of these metrics that you see here, Blue, Meteor, Rouge, and obviously Precision Recall, all of these are also preferred in the NLP domain. And these metrics have been borrowed from there, and they still hold true. But again, like there are still some issues here that we'll address towards the end. But these metrics are what are like, you know, what are typically referred to when people try to measure the quality of a model that generates code summaries. So starting with the first work, right, this came out in around 2016, and this was one of the first approaches that used a completely data-driven deep learning based approach. Again, like at that time, it was not pretty common to use deep learning neural networks for the domain of code summarization. There were some initial works, but they did not like, you know, produce very impressive results. But this particular work took inspiration from natural language processing, specifically machine translation, where you're given, say, a sentence in English and you want to translate it to French, you use an encoder-decoder model with an attention layer, right? And then you can do the same, and then you can get the corresponding French sentence. So you can take this analogy and apply it to a code summarization task where the code is the English sentence, so it is one language, and we can think of the corresponding documentation as the French sentence, right? So it's still a translation task where we're, instead of going from English to French, we're going from code to text. Right. So that is how this particular approach was modeled, and it works quite well. It's pretty intuitive if you're familiar with machine translation tasks, right? So the input output is pretty straightforward. You have a function text, right? So you split your input code in whatever language that could be into some tokens that you can see here, right? We have int, get sum, int array, and so on. So you split your function into a set of tokens, which becomes your input to the encoder of the model. In this particular case, the encoder is an RNN model, but it could be anything, right? So you, as long as it accepts your a sequence of inputs, right? So you have a bunch of tokens, you give it to the encoder, and it tries to come up with some hidden representation to encode the entire information within this code sequence, the token of code sequence that you gave, right? And then you apply attention on top of that and have the decoder generate the summary, which is the English description of what the code is supposed to be doing. So this is exactly how you address machine translation tasks in NLP domain. But the great thing about this particular work was this was one of the first works we kind of tried to model this problem in this particular way, and it did so very successfully, I would say, given the timeline when it came around. It was 5 years back, but given the rate at which the field is moving, I think 5 years is a pretty long time now. So they did quite well on the two data sets that they kind of evaluated on. So they crawled C# and SQL posts from Stack Overflow. They manually crawled them. And then the idea was to take the question of the Stack Overflow post and the accepted answer in one of the answers. And then we can match them to say, for this particular code snippet, this was what the question was. So this question probably describes the corresponding code snippet most accurately. So they use this pair as a training data. As you can see, the title and query pairs are used in the training data. and which is what they feed to the encoder decoder model. And they do the same thing for us for the SQL posts as well. And once they have that, they train their model after doing some pre-processing and cleaning. And then they did achieve state of the art results at that time. Like here you can see the results. Again, they're measuring the Meteor and the Blue scores, but they can clearly outperforming most of the popular methods that were available at that particular time. And apart from this, they also provide a lot of detailed analysis of the different attention weights that have been learned and try to understand how the model pays attention to different tokens in the code and matches it with the different tokens in the resultant output summary, right? So it, there's a lot of understanding that it try to extract out of that and what is actually happening within that model. And they do also measure some quality measures like, you know, naturalness and informalness, right? So there was one of the questions in the chat that these are all very subjective measures, and yeah, one of these papers do measure these kind of subjective measures as well. Again, there's no very clear definition, like widely accepted definition of naturalness and informativeness, but we do agree that I would like to make sure that my summary is like, you know, reads naturally and, you know, it's quite informative about the code summary. Right? So it's very, even though there's no fixed definition for these terms, we still do agree that these terms are like, these qualities are definitely desirable in the output that I get. So quickly moving on, right? So the next one is again, like this came out a bit later, but it's based on a similar principle. The key guiding motivation for this particular work was that the authors kind of had a hypothesis that API sequences or API invocation sequences, for example, your function calls within a given code snippet, right, carry a lot of information which tells you what exactly that code snippet is doing. So just the function calls without looking at the variable names or anything else, just the function calls by themselves could carry a lot of information about what that code snippet is doing. But the issue is that, you know, all the works by that time were not really focusing too much attention on that. So the approach here is that they want to extract some additional information from just the sequences of API calls or the function calls within a given code snippet. And they want to use that information to guide code summarization, to generate the summary for the code, right? So the API sequences or function calls, again, are extracted via some static analysis tools that you can, you know, get all the function calls that are present in a particular code snippet. That becomes a sequence by itself, a sequence of API calls and function calls. They use this sequence of API calls to learn a simple encoder decoder model like we saw earlier, right? That's what you see at the top of the figure here, this one particular section where they just extract the API sequences, feed it to an encoder decoder model and hope to generate some summary out of it. Again, like this summary might not really be that accurate because you're missing out, you're throwing away a lot of the information from the sequence of that code snippet, the entire code snippet itself. But still, like, the model must have learned something to make some kind of summaries out of just the API sequences, right? So now, given this trained model, now if we use this model in conjunction with the model that we saw earlier, right? Something like this, like something like an encoder decoder model, right? Here the input is again a pair of a code snippet tokens and the desired summaries, because you want to train the model on the desired summary, right? So you give the model a sequence of code tokens, which gets encoded via the encoder. Again, we have the same encoder, RNN-based encoder. Now, but in the decoder, right, instead of just relying on the encoded information from the code tokens, the decoder now also uses this information that was learned from the API sequences. So now in the decoder, when you are paying attention to the inputs, right, like when you have the attention layer, which pays attention to the different inputs, the different tokens in the inputs, in this particular model, the attention actually the attention layer pays attention to both the input tokens as well as the information that is extracted from the API sequences, which is what they're calling as transferred knowledge, because now you're transferring knowledge from the encoder of the API sequences and you're passing it to the decoder. So now there is this decoder which pays attention to both the API knowledge as well as the encoded knowledge from the token sequence. And it uses both of this information to kind of, you know, generate the actual summary. So it might look like, okay, yeah, there's nothing. It might look pretty straightforward, but actually it does end up doing well on the metrics that they were on. To evaluate their approach, they actually went ahead and crawled their own data sets, which was a pretty huge collection of Java methods along with their documentation strings that they crawled from GitHub. And they use this data set to kind of evaluate their approach. And as you can see here, there are multiple baselines that they tried against and multiple ablation studies that they did by removing each of these individual components. And they did kind of conclude that using their approach in this particular way, using this transferred knowledge, does actually end up performing much better than the other methods. So here you see the code NN method is exactly what we saw in the previous slide. And you can see how much it kind of, you know, how much the result differs from the code NN method. So it's a pretty significant jump, given that the philosophy, the ideology is still based on the encoder decoder models. So, okay, this is one of the more popular works. I would say, I think like it's used as a baseline for a lot of papers. And even until now, people have been using this work called Code2Sec from like, you know, to compare against their existing methods. So it's a pretty significant amount of, you know, there's a significant amount of attention given to this work even now, and it holds a lot of importance. The key differentiating factor here is that so far people have, the different models have been focusing primarily only on the sequence of tokens which are there in your code snippet. So you have a function, you just kind of tokenize it and give the entire tokenized code snippet as input to some encoder layer. But what the authors argue here is that this kind of a training process is missing a key information from the code, which is the structure within that code. So the hypothesis is that even though if you have code snippets which do exactly the same functionality, say for example, read or open a file, there are so many different ways to write that one particular function to read a file or open a file that the resulting code tokens might end up being completely different from each other, given how you want to implement that function, right? So, but for the purposes of code summarization, the summary for these all different implementations should still be the same, which is to open a file or read a file, right? So if you're just going to pay attention to the token sequences, you might end up predicting something else because you're not paying attention to what the functionality that is actually being performed within the code snippet. So the way in this paper addresses this problem is that they extract an AST out of the code snippet. Like, so for example, here's the code snippet, and this is the corresponding AST. So what they do is, for this particular AST, they look at all the terminal nodes and they extract all paths from any pair of terminal nodes. So if you have 10 terminal nodes, they will extract all possible paths from all possible beginning and ending terminal nodes. So all combinations of these nodes, you will get a path through the AST. So they extract all these paths, right? And then the idea here is like, again, like, no, for an arbitrary code snippet, these paths could be like, you know, a pretty high number, all the unique paths to the AST. So they fix a particular value of K, which could be something like 100 or 200, right? So that there is a maximum value of K. And they say like, no, I'm going to extract K paths from this AST at random. And I'm going to use these K paths to represent what this code snippet does, what this function does. And given this information, I'm going to train a network using just these paths. So to kind of put it in like one sentence, right? They have a network which takes as input some K paths which have been extracted from the AST, and each of these paths begins and ends in a terminal node of the AST. So now the novelty lies in how do they encode these paths and how do they feed it to a network. So now here you can see a kind of, you know, representation of what they are actually doing. So consider just this one path, right? If while expression or something, you have a sequence of tokens within the path. Like for example, here, if you look at it, this is a sample path name, method call, another name, and so on. And then there are these terminal nodes, string and index of. So this green path is encoded via this path encoder that you see here, which is an LSTM or some other RNN, right? So they encode the path using an LSTM. The terminal tokens, they encode separately. As you can see, both these encodings happening via some, just a simple dot matrix. So a dot product multiplication with an embedding matrix. So you have some representation of the beginning and the ending terminal tokens, and you have some representation of the path, which is encoded by an LSTM. Again, like I mentioned earlier, an abstraction would help here. The abstraction being that the LSTM over here will just take some path and will encode it into a fixed representation. So you have three fixed representations, which is three fixed length vectors out of these paths. And you have these for all the paths that you're considering. So for each path, you can see a green block, which kind of encodes the information about the terminal nodes of the path and the nodes within that path itself. So once you've extracted that, you feed this whole thing to another LSTM network, right? Which is going to be in your decoder. So once you have extracted all this information about the different paths, you aggregate them into a common, like the aggregation that you use here is an averaging. So you average all the hidden representations that you learned about these paths, you feed it to the decoder as the initial state. And the decoder is now it works as your standard decoder, where it's paying attention to all these different hidden representations that you computed for each of your paths, starting from the initial state. At each time step, it will generate some token as the output, right? So you're encoding all the paths via the encoder in this particular fashion. And the decoder now will take all these encoded paths as input, and it will generate the summary for what your method is doing. So again, like I mentioned earlier, if you abstract out individual components of this entire architecture, it will be much more clearer that it actually does try to capture everything that the method is doing, apart from the fact that, you know, that the number of paths that it's selecting is a limited value of k. So they do evaluate this whole architecture on a Java small, medium, large datasets, which they actually published in one of their earlier works. And the task that they're actually trying to solve is both code summarization as well as method name prediction. So here in the bottom table, you see the results for the method name prediction task, which you can see is pretty, it clearly outperforms everything that has come prior to that, even the transformers that was pretty famous around that time. And you can see this approach actually does a great job at predicting method names. And they also tried out this architecture on method documentation generation. And again, they compare with all the other works that we saw previously, including CodeNN, which was the first method that we saw. And again, they're outperforming it by a significant margin. And they actually have also released a publicly available a tool that you can just play around with. So you can give some function and it will generate for you this entire path. And it will generate for you the summary as well. So I think if you're interested in this, you should go around, go and play with that the tool that they have made publicly available. So the next one is a completely different approach to what we've been seeing so far. This approach relies a bit on graph neural networks. Again, like we don't want to talk about graph neural networks too much in this particular session, but to summarize, right, graph neural networks are a relatively newer focus in deep learning, where you kind of encode information within a graph so that all the nodes and all the edges of the graph are kind of encapsulated into some representation, and you use that representation to do all sorts of various tasks on that graph. So here, even though we don't really have a graph in code summarization, we do have a tree, which is our abstract syntax tree. So the justification for this particular approach was that all the sequence-based methods so far, they don't really work that well, because even though theoretically sequential methods like LSTMs and RNNs are supposed to capture long distance relationships between the different tokens, they don't really remember long dependencies between tokens. So a lot of the information is getting lost if two tokens are separated from each other by a lot of other tokens, right? So graph neural networks don't really have that problem, because they try to capture aspects of the entire graph into the different node representations. So the justification for this work was to make sure that we capture all that information that is available to us in the abstract syntax tree. But at the same time, we also want to make sure we don't lose the sequential information, because when you're writing code, when you're reading code, there is some sequence involved there, and that does hold some meaning. So we don't want to completely let go of the sequence information that is available in the code. But at the same time, we also want to consider the structure of the code, right, in terms of the abstract syntax tree. So what they do is they still have a standard encoder, the LSTM-based encoder. And this encoder, they give the entire code snippet as the input. So they have the sequence of tokens. You give it to your encoder, and the encoder will generate some representation for this entire sequence of tokens. Now, for each token, you have some representation that was given to you by your LSTM network. Now, what you're going to do now is you use this intermediate representations given to you by your LSTM, and use these representations to feed it to something like what you see here. So assert will get some vector from your LSTM network. This dot would get some vector. all the other tokens would get some vectors from your LSTM encoder network. Now you feed those token representations into these nodes as their initial states of the nodes, and then you train a graph neural network, which is again derived from your AST. So you have this AST, there are some edges, there are some nodes, which kind of forms like a graph. So what then the normal thing that they do here is, apart from the edges that are already present in the AST, they come up with their own set of edges, which kind of capture some semantics about the different tokens that are present in the input. For example, there is this not null identifier, and they want to break this into not and null, because there is some information that they feel should be captured here. This is not really a single token, single word. It's actually comprised of two words. So they want to split it, and they add an additional set of edges to say this one token is actually comprised of two tokens. Okay? So that is one additional set of edges that they add. The other set of edges is again the same edges as you have from the AST. So all these blue edges would be there. And finally, they also have the sequence edges. So in your AST, you would not have these bold edges, but they do add these new edges into their graph representation to connect the next tokens. Right? So assert dot not null, right? This is going to be what you have in your code snippet. So they establish edges between these nodes to capture that these nodes follow each other in the sequence of tokens. So they add all these edges, additional edges, into the graph representation, and then they learn like the graph embeddings for these words. So they initially start off with some embeddings given by the LSTM, then they run the graph representation learning network to refine these embeddings to capture all the information about everything else that is there in the graph. And the final embeddings that they arrive at for each of these tokens is what they use at the decoder layer along with attention to get the final result, right? So the approach goes like this. You have an input code snippet. You feed it to an LSTM to get some initial representations for each token in your code. Then these representations are fed to a graph neural network, which refines these representations to capture everything that is there present in the graph and come up with a new set of embeddings. Now, these set of embeddings capture everything that is present in your code, both structurally as well as in the sequence information, which is a much richer information than what you would get just by using a plain LSTM network. And this is then what is fed to the decoder network to extract out the entire summary. And they do try out a lot of different experiments. Again, like due to space constraints, I cannot show all the results. But here you can see that the variations, the different variations that they tried do perform very well compared to some of the other baselines that they have attempted. The self-attention is basically just the LSTM encoder decoder network with a self-attention, which kind of translates to a transformer network. So they do compare against this, and they also compare against a lot of other baselines. You can probably refer to the paper and get some more details out of that. But they do try a lot of different experiments, and it turns out adding this information in terms of the graph network actually helps a lot in capturing the information that we want to get, which is the summary. So this is again slightly, now we are moving into a complex and composite models territory. So here the idea was that the models that we learned so far, which is the LSTM based models most of the time, they don't really capture structural information of the code, like that we saw in the previous one as well, where we use graph networks. So the LSTM based networks don't capture structural information, and they also suffer from something called an exposure bias, which is happening a lot in the decoder of your text generation models. Again, I don't want to go into the details of exposure bias specifically for this talk, but it is a very common problem that you have in text generation models, because when you're generating the output, you rely on what was generated previously to decide what to generate next. Like for example, if I'm generating this title, right, improving automatic source code, to generate source, I need to know improving and automatic were generated previously. So now my next one is going to be source. But when you are actually generating in real time, right? So when you are training your network, you already know what is my desired sequence. So you train accordingly. But when you are generating in live production, right, like at testing time, the information that you generated previously might not always be accurate. So if the first token you generate itself is wrong, all the subsequent tokens, all the tokens that come afterwards are also most likely going to be wrong. So there's this problem called exposure bias, where the model is trained in one way, but it is tested in a slightly different way, and hence the outputs are not really reliable. So this is a very common problem in sequential decoder models, and it's seen a lot in text generation. So there are these two problems that with the approaches that we've seen so far, right? So what this paper kind of tries to address is they want to get rid of just the LSTMs because they want to capture sequential and structural information together. So along with a simple LSTM network that you see here, they also have a tree LSTM network which captures the structural aspect of your code. We'll go into I'll mention what this actually means. So they have two separate set of encoders. One is the sequential encoder, one is the tree encoder, which captures both sequential and structural information in the core. And then they feed it to a hybrid attention. Now, because we have two different types of inputs, we need two different types of attention layers as well. So the hybrid attention kind of selectively decides what tokens in the sequence and what tokens in the tree representation should I pay attention to. So there is a separate module that they propose, which kind of selectively decides where to pay my attention. So that's what they call the hybrid attention, because they're paying attention not just to the sequence, but also to the tree tokens. And that is then given to an actor critic based RL framework. So like I said, right, exposure bias is a problem in sequential RNN based generation models, but reinforcement learning methods don't suffer from exposure bias. So they propose that to get rid of the exposure bias problem, we use a actor critic based decoder. So the job of the decoder is to generate one token at a time, which is the action in the reinforcement learning framework. So they generate all these tokens, and when the decoder decides, okay, this is the last token, I'm not going to generate anything beyond that, the entire sequence of tokens is what is then taken as the output of my summary generator. So that is the entire framework is kind of the novel part here. And like I said earlier, it helps to think of this in abstract terms. So you have an encoder which takes in certain inputs and generates a fixed length representation. In this case, we have two fixed length representations, which is the sequence encoder, sequence encoded sequence, and the encoded tree information. So now coming to this, right? So in your sequential RNNs, you have a sequence of inputs, you give it to the RNN network one at a time, and the output also is produced one at a time, right? So and the previous tokens representation is then given to the next tokens RNN input to come up with some representation for the next token. But in the tree RNN, you capture the tree structure of the input. So if you have something like this, you don't really start from the left here, because you already start from the child node. So you start with the children nodes, and then the representation of the parent nodes, instead of over here, instead of looking at, so for example, right, O3 was dependent on O2 and O1 in this particular fashion. But here we realize that O1 and O2 are actually the children nodes of this particular node. So in that particular way, you're kind of capturing the information from the children nodes and using that to come up with a representation from the particular parent node. So the root of the AST here is going to capture the entire information about the entire AST, the entire sequence of code that you're providing as input. So that this is the primary difference here between the sequence encoder and the tree encoder. And this method uses both these encoders to come up with a representation for the input. And then they apply attention followed by a reinforcement learning based decoder. So the results are pretty impressive here. They use a different data set this time. They use it on a Python, they use this method on a Python data set, which is again like one of the data sets that we mentioned earlier. And they do observe that using this kind of a hybrid attention actually helps a lot, and it improves the result by quite a big margin, as you can see here. They compute all the different scores, blue, meteor, rouge, and cider. And you can see there's a big jump in how much this particular method kind of contributes to the learning, right? So the summary, the quality of the summaries are much better. But again, this is just a snapshot. They do conduct a lot of experiments. They compare against a lot of other baselines, and they do observe that all these individual components play a critical role in coming up with a good summary. And they show that the exposure bias problem is also kind of solved to a great extent. So overall, it's a pretty new take on the summary generation problems. And I think this inspired a lot of other work that considered reinforcement learning as a potential alternative to generate summary tokens. So finally, coming towards some of the newer works, right? This is a novel approach to the code summarization problem. The motivation here is code summarization takes as input a code snippet and generates a summary, which is kind of like the inverse problem of taking a textual description and generating a code sequence out of it. So the motivation here is these two problems are very similar to each other. It's just that the input output directions are reversed for them. So why not train a model which takes as input one set of, you know, let's say code, right, and generates a summary, and also tries to take the summary as input and generate the corresponding code snippet back, right? So there's this duality between these two tasks, and maybe we can train a network which kind of forces its duality to kind of cooperate with each other. So even though we train two different networks, one which takes care of, you know, code summarization and the other network which does code generation, but we can force this duality to come into play, and these both networks can learn from each other, and at the same time they can improve performance on both these tasks. So this is a pretty novel take on the problem of code summarization, and actually the results that they get is pretty interesting. So now, how do you enforce this duality, right? Like, what is the form of this duality? So for that, what they say is, like, let's say we have a code summarization model which takes as input a code snippet and generates a code summary, which is your text. Again, it could be a simple LSTM based, you know, encoder decoder with attention, like simple model what we have seen so far, just an attention based LSTM model. And your code generation model is also another attention based LSTM model, but it could take as input a textual description of the code, and it would give you as output the code snippet itself, right? The entire code snippet. So we have these two complementing models, and now we want to enforce a duality between them. So we want to make sure that they learn something from each other. So how do we do that? So the way they formulate this problem is there is a joint probability space of code and text, right? Where a certain piece of code and a certain piece of text, which is like the description for that code, have a very high probability, which is denoted by P of X, Y, right? This is a joint probability of the code and the text, right? So now we can decompose these joint probabilities into conditional probabilities like that, where your P of Y given X is the probability assigned by your model, your code summarization model, where Y is the summary, right? So the summary given the code. So you have a code summarization model which gives you some probability of this particular, of this joint probability, some estimate of this joint probability. And you have a code generation model similarly, which gives you another estimate of this joint probability. So now, because you are assuming that they are coming from a single joint distribution, you want to make sure that the probabilities assigned by these two models, your code generation model and the code summarization model, are kind of equivalent. So you want to enforce this constraint here, that the conditional probability learned by these two models are kind of similar. So they come up with one loss term, which kind of captures the difference in the conditional probabilities that is assigned by these two models, right? So that is what you see here. So again, like, this is because you're doing the log loss, they have taken this log terms, but it's essentially this probability minus this probability, and you want to minimize this difference. So you want to minimize the difference with difference in which these two models assign the probabilities to their individual output. So because they're coming from the same distribution, we want to make sure both these models assign the same probability, same joint probability to the code and the corresponding text, right? So the first loss term kind of just tries to minimize the difference between these two. So that is one loss that you add to your network. And the second loss is something very intuitive, something very novel here, right? So if you think about it, let's say you have a code snippet which is, say, you know, finding a particular string within another string, right? Just substring search. So you have a code snippet which has some string dot find on something else, right? And the corresponding summary for that code is find a string within another string in plain English text, right? So there is an alignment, a relation between the find in the text and the find in your code, right? So these two find tokens have some alignment, and they should have been paying attention to each other when your model is learning something, right? So if there is a find in your code input, it should translate to a find token in the output of the decoder in the summary. So there is this duality between the tokens in the code, and there is this duality kind of expressed within the attention that the model gives. So now if you think of attention in an abstract term, it tells you how much attention I should pay to all the inputs in order to generate a particular output. So if my output is going to be find, there is another input find that I need to pay high attention to. And similarly, when my output is a find from the text and there is a find keyword in my code, these two find tokens should get very high attention, right? So there is a symmetry in the tokens, in the attentions that you pay to different tokens. And that is what they kind of, you know, enforce via additional loss function. So they use the attention weights for a given token as a probability distribution, and they want to make sure that each token in one of the models has a symmetric attention distribution in the other model. So they want to enforce this symmetry, and that is what they have here. Again, you can look into the proofs and the details of this into the paper, but this is what they're trying to enforce here. They want to enforce the symmetry between the attention weights, because you have this duality problem here, right? Between the problem, the tasks that they're trying to solve. So given these two losses, right, the dual loss and the attention loss, they train their networks using these two losses as regularization terms. And then they actually arrive at a model which enforces the duality and learns both these tasks together, and consequently kind of does better at both these tasks at the same time. So here you see their evaluation on just the code summarization task. I'm not showing the results for the generation task, but for code summarization task, right, you can see they're comparing against most of the approaches that we have seen earlier, and it's clearly outperforming them again. And this is pretty interesting, because now when you actually observe the attention weights that was learned, because you're enforcing this attention duality, this attention symmetry, if you look at the attention matrices, right, of what you're showing here, you can see there's a lot of, it's very similar, right? Like, again, this is the transposed version of them, but you can see that the attention matrices are very similar, and this duality actually enforces this, right? So it does look like, both these models are paying the same attention to the same sets of terms, which is exactly what we wanted. So again, I encourage to read this particular paper. I think it's pretty interesting take on this entire core summarization problem. So again, I just want to do a quick time check. I think we do have some additional time. So let me quickly cover some of the more recent works. Again, these have just come in the past 1 or 2 years. So the first one is, again, based on transformers. Now, transformers have been around for a long time in NLP and in translation tasks. But people have tried out transformers as a baseline, but they've not really been doing very well. So the problem here is, first of all, transformers are not really, the LSTM networks, the RNN-based networks, are not really able to capture long sequential information, right? That we already know that if there is a long dependence between tokens, core tokens, the LSTM networks are not really being able to do that. So that is one issue. The other thing is, they're not really able to capture non-sequential information. What I mean by that is, if there is a pair of tokens which are supposed to be very closely associated with each other. So for example, there's a variable declaration at the beginning of your code snippet, and the variable actually is getting used right towards the end. There's a very high chance that your model is not really paying attention to these two occurrences, because it doesn't really get a chance to capture the sequential information, right? So there is a big jump in the sequence, right? If something is occurring at the beginning, something is occurring at the very end, right? So the model is not able to associate that these two tokens are actually the same token, and maybe they do share a lot of information. So these two are pretty common problems in RNN-based models. So transformers do help in this extent, but for the specific use case of code summarization, they need to be adapted a little bit. So now we saw earlier that transformers kind of get rid of your sequential information that you have in LSTMs, but then in place of that, to kind of compensate for that, they have this positional encoding, right? It tells you which token follows which another token. So they add a certain vector to representation of each input to capture the position information for that particular input token. So these position encodings are kind of absolute, in the sense that the first token, second token, third token, and so on, right, will have a fixed value of position encoding. But the novelty in this particular work is kind of inspired by another work which came out all the way in 2018, where instead of giving an absolute positional encoding, they prefer a relative positional encoding. What this means is each token kind of captures its relative position with respect to other tokens in the code. So this is encoded and this is added to the embedding vectors of each token, rather than just the absolute positional encodings. And apart from that, they use something called copy attention. Now, again, this is pretty new. What this means is, a lot of the times you have something, a specific keyword in your code, right, which is not really part of your vocabulary, say, for example, right? I don't know what this particular token means, but it's there in my code snippet. So a lot of the times you just want to use that particular token as the output. So if you have a very business specific term in the code snippet, right, like for example, if I'm working on a financial domain, there is probably calculate interest somewhere in my code snippet. Now, interest might mean something completely different in my textual language description. There are multiple interpretations of the word interest. But because this is a financial domain, interest means something very specific. And like, if it was some completely different domain where I don't know what this particular word means, like that, I don't know what interest means, but I still want it in my output. So now how do I get it from my input to the output without the output knowing that there is a word called interest anywhere in my vocabulary? So this copy attention basically tells you that, okay, this particular token that you're paying attention to, I just want to copy as it is to the output. So I don't want the decoder to generate a particular token, right, for this particular position. I just want the decoder to copy the position, the token from this particular position directly into the output. So that's what the name kind of suggests, that, you know, you copy a token from the input directly into the output. So they introduce these two changes into the plain transformer based model, and they observe a lot of big performance gains on the transformer. So we have seen some of the previous papers that they tried to use transformers as baselines, but they were not really doing that great. But here they compare against a lot of other previous baselines, and they do show that now with these specific positional encodings and copy attention, here you can see the ablations that they've done. These two enhancements do help the overall task of core summarization, and they greatly enhance the performance of the transformer as well. So this is another work that again came out very recently, and it's again based on the transformer based framework. But the differentiating factor here is they train a bimodal model. What this means is it takes both the code and the corresponding text as input. So you don't have a separate encoder for a code and a separate encoder for a text. You give both of them as input to the model. And the job of this particular model is to learn some kind of a relation between the code and the corresponding text. So we know there is some relationship between the code and the text. We don't know what that is. We leave it to the model to figure that out. And given these kind of pairs of codes and corresponding texts, we expect the model to learn the relationship, to learn what is the common embeddings, common structure within the code and the corresponding text, and use that for your downstream code tasks, right? So they have this bimodal model. We call this bimodal because we have two modalities. One is a code modality and one is a text modality. And we use them together to come up with a model. The other interesting thing is they train this model on not just one language, they train it on six languages at the same time. So all the inputs, they're not really specific to just one particular language. They work on the CoreSearchNet dataset, where you can see here they have six languages as the in the dataset. And all of these six languages are given to the model at the same time. So there's no separate model for each language. So there is a single model which learns information about six languages and at the same time the corresponding text documents, right? The text summaries. So the way this works is they have a generator model which takes as input some code snippets and some tokens, but certain tokens from these code and, you know, text tokens have been masked out. What this means is the model does not receive these tokens. Now the job of this generator model is to predict what was masked out. Like, for example, if you see here the first position of masked out, then now the generator would generate some estimate of what this first token is going to be. So it will generate all these estimates for all the tokens that have been masked out. And then the discriminator network, which is another network, in this particular case, they use a BERT model, which is a variation of a transformer model. So they use this network to say, okay, now this input was given to me. The job of this model, discriminator model, is to figure out which ones were the original code tokens or the text tokens and which ones were the replaced tokens that were generated by this generator. So if you see, in some way, there is no information, like you're not really telling the model what to do. It just kind of tries to figure out what is correct and what is wrong, right? Like which tokens were actually belong in this particular place and which tokens were kind of replaced or misplaced or something like that, right? So it would be surprising, like, you know, if it learns something useful at all, but it actually does end up learning something very, very interesting. And this entire architecture was borrowed from something called an Electra model, which is again one of the variations of a transformer. So this was inspired by an Electra model. And what it does is it ends up mapping the code and the text, the corresponding text, to some embedding space where they share the meaning, right? Like, you know, if there is a particular vector in the embedding space, that vector kind of, you know, tells you something about what that code is doing. And a similar vector somewhere near that original vector tells you what a corresponding textual description of that code snippet could be, right? So the job of this discriminator is to take this code and textual inputs and map it to some common space, which can then be used for downstream tasks, which is, in our case, core summarization, right? So they train this complicated model. And once you have the trained model, you have this discriminator, which is a transformer-based model. You feed this discriminator as input to a decoder network, again, which is another transformer. The job of the decoder network now is to take as input the code. Say, for example, because you're doing code summarization, it takes as input the code, and then it will generate a sequence of tokens as text, right? Which is your desired summary of the code. And clearly, they outperform most of the baselines here. Okay, the other thing is, because they are just dealing with code and text in a joint space, right? You could use the same model for code search or code retrieval without changing anything about it. Because now, instead of just giving a code sequence as input, you give a text sequence as input. And then it would try to find the most matching, the closest matching code sequence, which is there in your database. And then you can use that as a possible answer to your code search problem. So in this way, the same model can be used for both code search and code summarization. And I'm just showing you results on the code summarization, but they have some very impressive results on code search as well. I kind of encourage you to look into the paper. But the other cool thing that they try to do is this model was trained on just the 6 languages from the code search net dataset. But at the same time, they tried to see if it had learned something very interesting at all. So what they did is they went to the original, the first paper that we talked about, which trained they trained an LSTM network on the C# dataset. They took the dataset as it is, but they did not train the model on the C# dataset, and they just fed it to the model. And still the model was able to do a great job at generating summaries of the C# code, even though it had never seen C# code at all before, right? It was never trained on C# code. But at the same time, it was still able to generate great summaries for C#. As you can see here, it almost reached the best accuracy that was available at that time, which was a 4-to-6 model. But even without seeing the C# code, it was still able to generate summaries for C#, which I think was pretty impressive. The only downside is this is a pretty large model. It's a very complicated model. So training it could be difficult. Luckily, they do provide trained models and implementations for this architecture. But if you want to train it on something from scratch, it could be slightly difficult because of the kind of fine tuning and the models involved here. So now coming back to the problem of code and structural aspects of code and sequential aspects of code, right? Again, this is a new perspective into this problem where so far we've only been looking at the sequential aspects of code, just the code tokens. But if you want to kind of pay more attention to the structure of the code, right? Like this work kind of takes a slightly different approach to that. So what they have is again, same encoder decoder approach, where you have a code sequence, you encode it via some RNN-based encoder, but you also have an AST that you have available to you. So sometime prior to this work, there was a method that kind of generates a sequence out of your AST while preserving all the structure and the semantics within that AST. So it takes a tree as an input, but generates a sequential representation of that tree, which is something called structure-based traversal. I'll talk about it towards the end a little bit, but the essence is that it takes an AST as an input and generates a sequence of tokens which represents that AST. But now that you have the sequence of tokens for that AST, you can similarly train an AST encoder the same way you trained your code encoder, which is your token sequence, right? So you train an AST encoder which captures everything about your AST, again using just an LSTM based network, and you use that to initialize a code encoder, which is your encoder which takes your code tokens as an input. So now you have two encoders, one which is completely based on ASTs and one which only relies on code tokens, the code snippet information, right? So you have two encoders available to you. The same way you can probably apply two different attentions, and then you can combine these two attentions and give it to your decoder to generate some summary, right? Okay, so there is nothing extremely different from what we've seen earlier. It's just that the way they kind of use this structure-based traversal, this is the work that came out earlier in 2018, to convert an AST into a sequence. They use that to capture the structural aspects of the code that is provided by the AST, and they use that along with the sequential aspects from the code snippet and combine it together to form some representation, which is then used for generating your code summaries. So again, they try out on a few baselines in this particular case, but you can look at the paper for more details of their analysis. They do try to understand what's actually happening here in the attention layers and how the different attention attention weights and attention vectors are generated and what they actually correspond to in this encoded representation, right? So there is some analysis that they have provided in the paper where they kind of try to understand what is actually happening. But result wise, I think they still outperform the baselines that they've considered. It's not really that, they don't really do a very great job at kind of, you know, the results. They're still somewhat behind some of the baselines that they considered. But this kind of lays a good framework for the next one, which came out again by the same authors, by the same team, sometime last year. Now, the only difference here is instead of the AST-based encoder, right, the structure-based traversal encoder that they use here, which is based on LSTMs, they replace this encoder using a graph neural network. So which is what you see here. We have this convolutional graph neural network block here, which is what they replace the LSTM with. But the rest of the network more or less remains the same. Again, like, you know, I probably won't do justice by saying more or less, but it's there is still a lot of similarities between this work and this particular work. And they do take inspiration from this work to kind of, you know, come up with this representation of the AST, right? So now they use a graph neural network to capture everything that's there in the AST, because naturally, yes, graph neural networks do a better job of capturing information from the AST compared to something like, you know, something like an LSTM. So then combined information from the graph neural network and the source tokens, they apply a similar set of attentions, which is then combined to generate the output. So in principle, the work is very similar here, again, it's by the same authors. It's just that they replace this one block with something that's much more effective and much more efficient at capturing what this block is supposed to be doing anyway, right? So, and they, in this particular case, they do a lot of ablation studies and they do a lot of comparisons to show that their work is actually making a lot of the results that they're getting is a lot more better than what they were getting using their previous approach, as well as they do compare against some of the other baselines, and they show that this graph neural network approach actually does well. One interesting thing that they kind of identify is the graph neural networks actually capture information that is a certain hops away from a particular node, right? So if your node is an identifier or a variable, right, all the associated nodes in the graph neural network kind of contribute to the representation for that identifier or variable node, right? So what this means is the farther you spread up, spread in the graph, like the more information you look for in the graph, the more information from the rest of the code snippet is captured into the node that you're currently visiting, right? So what they discover is, like, no, most of the time, only nodes which are two hops away in the graph usually capture enough context that is required for code summarization. You can still do more hops in the graph, but they don't really contribute that much. And they, even though they capture more information about the functionality of the method in general, they don't do that great of a job. Like, you don't really need to go so far away. You can just get enough information from two hops within the graph to kind of capture capture enough information to do a good job at code summarization. So I'm going to quickly now, like, given the time, I'm just going to quickly go to the last work. Again, this is the most recent work that came out, and they kind of outperform everything that we have seen so far in a completely different approach, right? The way they kind of present their framework is, like, completely different from what we have been seeing so far. So now they kind of go back to the original self-attention and position encodings all the way, right? The actual meaning of self-attention is that if you have multiple layers in your neural network, right, the representation for this particular token, the jth token in this layer, has to be derived from the representation of all the other tokens in the layer before that, right? So each token gets a chance to influence the representation for the current token in the next layer, right? So you can write this relationship in this way, that the attention that the token J gets, the attention relationship between token I and J, right, in these two layers, can be expressed as some matrix multiplication. Again, like, I don't want to go into the semantics of this, but you can look at this paper to kind of understand what they're trying to say. But the gist is that a given pair of token positions have some relationship that can be expressed like this, for their attention, the amount of attention that they get, right, between them. So the amount of attention between token J and token I can be expressed like this. Now, what we saw earlier, right, you add some position encodings to an embedding of a layer, to some representation that layer learns about a token so that you capture positional information. So this, the same equation here can be expressed like this, where this phi function is your positional encoding for that particular token. Right? So exactly the same terms, we're just expressing it slightly differently by adding the positional encoding term. Now, when you have these terms here, this is what your attention weight kind of now represents. So the attention relationship between I and J can be expressed as some in the same fashion, except for the positional term added here. Now, again, like you can do some math, linear algebra, and you can arrive at some factorization of this particular equation, and you can have these four terms. Now, these four terms have very specific meanings, but we just want to focus on these two terms here, right? So here, this is the AIJ matrix that we are looking at here. The relationship, the attention between position I and position J can be expressed like this. But here's this term, phi of PJ, which is the position encoding that is given to term J, right? And we have this phi of I terms as well, which is the positional information for that ith token. Now, we know that a phi is the absolute position encoding, but we can arbitrarily replace phi with some relative position encoding, which does not really depend on the absolute position of that particular token, right? So here what you see is, instead of looking at the absolute attention, I can define this as a relative attention between two token positions based on certain function phi, which captures a relation information between two tokens. So here, instead of just the absolute position of token J, which is PJ, I want to define some relative position between tokens I and J. So I can just replace this phi function with some other corresponding phi function, which does not take into account the absolute positions, but takes into account some relative information between the tokens that I'm, the token positions that I'm interested in, right? So that is it's a pretty drastic shift. But if you think of it in abstract sense, it's pretty much equivalent that instead of just using a absolute position information, you're using a relative position information. And otherwise, the entire attention formulation still remains the same, right? So that is the key novelty here. So now what could comprise what could be this new relational information, right? So that is where this work kind of introduces a lot of different distance measures. So now, because we are just looking at some relative information between two sequences of tokens, or two given pair of tokens. So they define four relative distance measures that you can use instead of the position encoding. So instead of the absolute position encoding, you are using two relative measures, which still capture information about the role of these two tokens that you're interested in within the code snippet. So again, in the interest of time, I'm not gonna talk into too much into how they actually arrive at this, but I just want to point out that they use these four different relative position encoding methods, where they capture different aspects of relations between a given pair of tokens. And each of these aspects comes with its own set of metrics, right? Like you have, because now you're looking at a pair of tokens, you have a matrix. Each cell in the matrix represents some relation between that corresponding pair of tokens. So you have arrived at some metrics, but you can still use the same attention formulation, and you can still apply self-attention on the same network. So they have a transformer layer where, instead of your typical self-attention, they use this relative distance-based self-attention and use this information to capture everything there is about the relationship between different tokens in the code. And then they follow it with a decoder layer, which generates tokens at the output. So again, like thinking of this in abstract senses, you have pretty much the same building blocks. It's just that the definition of those building blocks is now changed to capture relative positions and relative information between a pair of tokens. And results wise, I think you can pretty much see that they outperform all the baselines that they've considered. And another interesting thing that they do is, like, again, like CodeBot, they train a multi-language model where they don't consider a different model for a different programming language. They have a same model where they give all the programming languages in the data set as input, and they train a single model to generate summaries for all of these, for all the languages that they have as input. And they compare against several baselines again for this multilingual model, and they clearly do much better compared to the other approaches. So again, yeah, like
Urkka, just we need to finalize in a couple of minutes, just to be sure that everything fits in the space for the mirroring session.
Yeah. So I'm almost done now. So like, again, like, you know, due to the time constraints, I'm probably missing out a lot of work, but there is a lot of things happening in the code summarization space, and you can see some of the other papers that are pretty interesting. But again, due to the time constraints, I probably won't be able to talk about them. But yeah, you can check them out, and like, I think all these papers should definitely pique your interest in the entire space of code summarization. So now, given all this, right, like, you know, just to kind of, you know, consider where we have come from. Given the initial methods of rule-based and template-based, you know, approaches, I think we've come a long way using deep learning and, you know, data-driven methods, where we're able to generate consistent, like, we're able to generate summaries, like, you know, pretty clearly, and without additional inputs from the user, right? But still, the problem here is, like, we still don't have a consistent way to generate summaries. If you look at the actual summaries that have been generated, even though metric-wise we are doing well, there is still a lot of places where we can improve in terms of fluency and, you know, consistency and so on. But clearly, you know, all the works that have been going on in NLP and, you know, deep learning in general have greatly contributed to this this problem. And we're still kind of, you know, learning from all the advances in other fields and trying to see, you know, if they can help in code summarization. Luckily for us, like I said earlier, we have a lot of data sets available to us. So now, you know, it's just a matter of picking something up and trying out something new, right, and see if it works. So, but clearly, you know, so far from all the approaches we have seen, we definitely need both code token representation as well as structure representation in forms of AST or something equivalent. But like, clearly, we need both this information to be able to do a good job. But again, like, there's a lot of open questions around, you know, does this really say something about the problem in general, or can we get away with just, you know, considering one form of representation compared to other? And going forward, what the field kind of truly needs is some understanding of, you know, what's actually happening behind the scenes, right? Deep learning is kind of, you know, like, notorious for, like, you know, not having explainable models. But here we can see, right, you know, one example is all the embeddings, all the hidden representations that we've learned. Can we come up with some understanding of what these representations represent? And finally, we probably want to go slightly beyond just specific tasks, code summarization, code search, and code generation, and so on, and move something towards a model of code understanding, where we have some understanding model which just takes as input and as code and just understands something about code in general, rather than just kind of, you know, being tailored to a particular task. At the same time, there are a lot of things that still need to happen in the areas of text generation, because that directly ties into the advances in code summarization. So there are still a lot of open problems in text generation which need to be solved. Like, one of them I mentioned is the exposure bias issue. So we have a lot of things that could potentially help us in the future. And apart from the additional metrics and something, we don't really, like one of the questions earlier, right? Like, we don't really have a well-defined set of metrics that exactly specify what is a good summary and what is a bad summary. We have some metrics that we have adopted from other fields, but they probably don't really mean that well in the context of code summarization. And in general, we also like to understand world knowledge. What I mean by this is, as humans, we know the domain, we know the code, we know how codes are written and how we can understand code, but the algorithm is only aware of what it has been presented. So in order to capture the generic information about world and the knowledge and the domain that it's being kind of, you know, representing, I think some work needs to be, you know, involved there, which probably can come from a transfer learning kind of a paradigm, right? So there's still like open questions there. Like, can we bring something from other parts of the world to help us in code understanding and, you know, code summarization in general? And obviously, all the examples that we've seen define specific code summaries in the sense that they do, you know, what open a file, right, or read a file, or perform a string search. But there is no data set available that captures business domain logic, right? Like, how do I can calculate interest rates, or how do I predict the next stock price, or something like that, right? That captures a lot of, like, there's a lot of business rules involved which cannot be just coded into a program. So those kind of problems are still open, and like, we're definitely missing data sets to begin with, but that is something that now we can hopefully see in the future as well. So yeah, I think that was it from my side.
Thank you so much, Utkars and also Skirant. Now I will officially close the technical briefing, in the sense that I'm going to stop recording.